picture, the Wingbird picture of Comet Ison. It's a trident, and it's a double trident, clear as can be. And that happened on the Festival of Lights, Hanukkah. Okay, this was the perihelion or something with Comet Ison, I think was what, closest to the Earth at that point, and had this it displayed as this trident, or a menorah, right? Double menorah, a five-pointed menorah, the menorah of death, actually. And then you get all the symbology of tridents happening right now, this disappearance of this airplane, which is very, no matter what they say, it is very strange. No explanation really adds up at this point. You know, nothing actually holds much water at this point. Every theory, you know, pilot suicide, it doesn't quite add. It doesn't really add up. I don't think that, looking carefully at the pilot, I don't believe at this point that that's what happened. And who, you know, what kind of, you know, just incredible instability would lead to somebody saying, oh, I'm going to commit suicide, so I'm going to bring all these 239, how many people on the plane, 250 with the flight crew, I'm going to bring them all down with me. I mean, are you kidding? You know, that is incredible instability. And I just don't see it at this point. Okay, so we don't know what happened, but the symbology of this trident, the symbology is very powerful. There's no question it's being utilized, and there are connections here. The Maserati commercial in the Super Bowl is just terrifying. You know, the trident symbology, and what they say in the commercial is saying that they're going to, we at least suspect that they're going to strike. They are going to strike an ison in the sky, bringing this trident symbology. So we have, you know, World War III, and what does it stand for, the trident? It stands for World War III. It stands for three. It stands for the Third World War. That's what it stands for. And so the Third World War has begun, and I said I noticed it on the 10th. It might have started on the 8th, actually, when the plane disappeared. But I noticed it. I said, for sure, it's begun. So I said the 10th, because that's when I noticed it. But it might have started, actually, with the disappearance of that plane. It might have been an Illuminati sort of thing, or those who the activity of the ego may have used the disappearance of the plane in some ritualistic sort of way or something. Very possible. This is very weird stuff going on with the whole situation. The whole Ukrainian situation, again, with Crimea basically now being signed off as part of Russia. It's just the whole symbology of what's taking place in the world is getting everybody to think, you know, World War III is here, actually. And again, it's an ideological conflict at its root. It's the ego basically reneging on its promises of, let's see if we can balance out the two groups here on this planet. The ego's now saying, you know what, it didn't work, this one side's going to have to dominate. Fine. Well, the other side is going to go somewhere else then, okay? So it is. World War III is about the end, is the Armageddon of the end times, where the ego basically decides it's going to impose a one new world order, a one world money, a currency, and a one world religion upon the entire planet, and it's going to try and get rid of anybody who will not play by its rules. And it's going to give up any pretense of fairness or allowing two groups, you know, to don't agree with each other to both be here on this planet. It's going to give up any pretense of fair play or fairness whatsoever. And that's World War III. And it's already happening. World War III is already happening, which is why people, they realize, wow, something's really up in the world. There's no question about it. And the information, the warning I got was right on the money. Early March, and you had to have your spiritual will at a high state of readiness by March 17th, St. Patrick's Day. Very interesting day, St. Patrick's Day. I didn't even know it was St. Patrick's Day until later. I said, oh my gosh, that's pretty interesting. Because St. Patrick may have been a great saint, actually. May have been a great saint. because he actually asked the Holy Spirit to give him prayers and help in his contemplation. And as a, he was a slave, actually. St. Patrick was a slave. He was enslaved. He was raided by the Irish, the Druids, whoever lived there, and taken off to Ireland as a slave when he was a young 16-year-old. And as he was tending the sheep, or you know, taking care of this, the, whatever he was doing over there, he would pray, and he would spend his time in deep spiritual exercise with the Holy Spirit, with the Holy Spirit. Okay, now he was not receiving communion over there. There was no Catholicism. There was no Catholicism in Ireland at all. It was totally pagan. So what he was doing was he was asking the Holy Spirit to send right spiritual practice to him so he could practice. And in this practicing, he had this breakthrough, and had breakthroughs that developed into the vision of oneness, where before he hated his captors, he hated the Irish, he hated everything, and he now saw God in everyone. God in all the plants, the trees, the sky, the whole, every person, every situation, he saw God everywhere. That's the vision of oneness. That is the vision of oneness. And he did it with the Holy Spirit. And he did it in this pastoral setting, actually. He was out just, I think, just tending the sheep. A shepherd of the sheep. See, and then he again converted the countryside. He left and came back later. Was made a bishop in France, I think. Came back and tried to convert the countryside. But you know, historically, Ireland suffered a great deal. As a matter of fact, when the great famine, potato famine, hit Ireland, the people there were living in some of the worst squalor in the history of this planet, actually. Those who visited said it was so appalling, the living conditions of many people in Ireland. Well, they were slaves, essentially, of Great Britain. Indentured servants who had no rights, no money, no nothing, really, and just living in these rundown shacks, if they're lucky, in absolute squalor, with no medical care. They were living in some of the worst conditions of any people in the history of this planet, the Irish were. So, you know, it didn't exactly result in better conditions for the Irish at that time, that is for sure. So they gone through many trials and tribulations, and many of them joined the priesthood because it was the only way to get out of the squalor and the poverty, and then they were sent all over the planet, and they got out of Ireland. Really, it was a way out. It was a way out. So it didn't necessarily mean that they were enlightened, had the vision of oneness. Not at all. I mean, if you're starving and you say, "Wow, if I just join the seminary and agree to, you know, do what they say and everything, maybe made ordained a priest and do the mass the way they tell me, I'll be fed. I'll have a house. I'll be fed. I won't die in this hideous squalor, very violent, dangerous place." So you say, oh sure, that's a way out. It doesn't mean that you have the right spiritual will to reach the vision of oneness. It doesn't mean that at all. So now our bishop is Irish, but in looking at him, he doesn't have the vision of oneness. Absolutely not. So I'm not going to, you know, ask him for spiritual advice. And he doesn't... ask the Holy Spirit for spiritual advice is the best advisor. And if there's someone that you do feel is giving advice that's come from the Holy Spirit, then that can be helpful. It can be helpful. But ultimately, everyone has to ask the Holy Spirit, the voice of reason within, the blessing that God has given us, the way that God has given us to lead us to the vision of oneness, which solves the continuity problem. Listen to that intelligence, because it's pure. All right, it's unalloyed. It's not compromising with the ego, and so it will tell us what spiritual practices to utilize to get to the vision of oneness. That's its only goal for us. Its only goal has a singular goal for us: get to the vision of oneness. It doesn't say after you die you're going to heaven. It doesn't say that at all. It says you have, whether you're living in this world or living in some other place, living in some afterlife or living in some other dwelling place, whatever dwelling place you're living in, you have to abide in the vision of oneness to be reminded of reality. There is no way around that. No way around that. And Jesus says, except you be born again, You cannot enter the kingdom of heaven, which means accept that you have the vision of oneness. That's actually being born again. That's actually what it means. Because you have a new perception. When you're born, what do? You're perceiving. You feel, oh, look at this new perception, new world, new place, new perception, sensory perception, vision of oneness. You see through all things, as it were. You see thingness is no longer thingness. It's all oneness. It's like a new birth, a birth of a new world. Like, it's all oneness. That is the rebirth that Jesus talked about. He's not talking about a physical rebirth. Not talking about a physical rebirth. Unless you have the vision of oneness and abide in the vision of oneness, you cannot remember reality. Period. Sri Anandamayi said exactly the same thing. She says, there is no way around it for anyone. Every single one of you have to abide in the vision of oneness eventually. There's no other, you cannot avoid it. See? And you have to do that in order to truly enter into your true identity, your true state. Exact same teaching. No way around it. Okay. No way around it. So throughout history, the great teachers have said, there's no way around this. So you might as well ask the one whose only goal, whose only purpose is to guide you to the vision of oneness. You might as well ask them for advice. It's within each one of us, that advice. St. Patrick didn't have anyone advising him in Ireland. He went to the Holy Spirit directly and says, I need help, please. Each one of us can do that, you see. But at this day and age, with the global control mechanisms available, it's a big difficulty. Now, this Malaysian plane thing is very interesting because there's different levels to it. No question it has the symbology of the double trident, death, etc. But everyone, the passengers, somehow disappeared from the world. With all this technology that we have to monitor and control everybody, these 250 people, whatever, they vanished. They vanished. Even though they were in the world, in this plane, which in the world, with the double trident, somehow they disappeared and nobody knows where they are. Very interesting on that level. It could very well symbolize the rapture or going to another dwelling place. It could very well symbolize that. That no matter this total, this extreme global control that is in place, where everything is being monitored, everything has been being recorded, all data is being stored on everything. You know, with all these radar, personal radar, and everybody really now, your phone telling exactly where you are, who you're calling, your email, it's all being scanned, everything. You may be able to completely disappear from that. Nobody will be able to find you, actually. Go to another dwelling place that they can't find you where you are at all. They can't find you. They don't know where you are. So it's a very interesting way to look at the situation. It is, because this pilot was like very pro-democracy pilot. He's a pilot that actually wanted freedom. You know, he's very much for freedom. And felt it, self-determination and all this stuff. So maybe the pilot was actually a very good person. I don't know. It's possible. People who knew him said he really was. He was a very good person who really was a very fearless person standing up for democracy in this one percenter system of Malaysia. The deforesters, you know. And so maybe this is all a symbolic thing. Maybe they were all raptured. I don't know. But maybe the pilot was not suicidal. You know, I don't know, but it can be interpreted in certain different ways, you know. It can be interpreted in different ways. And maybe those who say, hey, we want another dwelling place, maybe they aren't crazy. Maybe they're not suicidal, not at all. Maybe they're saying, you know what, we just don't want to live under the severe repression and suppression and wrong-mindedness, and really impossibility, because what the ego will tell us is, hey, you got to combine the two right now, okay? And if you can't do it right now, then you got to drop all your spiritual practice and get with this new secular agenda, which will have a patina of spirituality to it, a mush of spirituality to it. Just a mush. And they're all, you know, it's possible to throw all sorts of stuff up there that kind of people say, oh yeah, you know, that's cool, I think that's kind of spiritual. But basically the default is, let's just be nice to people. Just get along with people. Just be tolerant of people. You know, and they'll plug in these various things from various religions. Say, oh yeah, Radical Dzogchen said, it doesn't matter what you do. You can do what you can have any lifestyle you want. It doesn't make any difference. You know, you don't have to be disciplined. You don't have to need any spiritual practice. You don't need any of that stuff. Just be kind to another. Means what? I mean, I guess don't kill them. I guess it means, right? Or if you do, that's your lifestyle too. I guess they'll say, well, yeah, some people just have that lifestyle. That's okay too. You don't need to worry. It's all okay. You know, they'll use these bits and pieces from different religions to mold some sort of thing that suits the ego's purpose. And of course, that won't last either. The ego will, again, people start getting worried. The ego will have to bring back the death of God killing the son thing, saying, hey, that's just perfectly okay to have that. Don't worry. Don't think you have a problem. You know, don't think you got a problem. Don't think you have a continuity problem. Don't think that you've been trying to get rid of God, actually, which is what we have been trying to do. We have. So, in other words, that which God created is not trying to get rid of God, the Creator. And so we project and attempt to do that. We actually project the ego, and the ego has the same feeling to us. It wants to get rid of us. And it scares us so bad. And we're so worried. And the ego says, don't worry. God's all for that. Don't worry. And of course the ego can say, don't worry, because its goal is to annihilate us. And when we're annihilated, what worries do we have? None. The ego says, I know a way to cure all your worries. Sure it does. Annihilate us. The only problem is we can't be annihilated. So the ego's way doesn't work. And whatever the ego does, it doesn't last long. It doesn't work. There's always fear there, and projection, and shifting, changing, constantly. So it thinks it's going to make this beautiful secular paradise here, but that won't last either. There'll be all sorts of problems, terrible problems. And they'll just medicate everybody like crazy, of course. And like always, they'll say the new medication is just, you know, it's in the trial phase. Don't worry. You're freaking out over some thing, you just have no idea what's wrong with you, and oh, don't worry, we have something ready for you. It'll be ready soon. That'll work for you. And oh, it's not, we'll just up the dose. Oh, well, let's combine it with something else. Doesn't work, combine it. You know, well, let's do some genetic snipping here. Let's do a selective laser lobotomy on you, and all that kind of stuff is here. It's it'll be mainlined very soon. They're already talking about it. You listen to the progressives talk, and their talk basically revolves around, you know, what are we going to do with the religious people? Exactly what sort of treatment are we going to give to them? That they already, it's a given in their minds that they're completely insane already. And it's a given that they have to be eliminated somehow. So they're just discussing, you know, how do we do it? We give them all laser lobotomies? Put them on heavy meds? Put them on a plane into the Indian Ocean. You know, what do we do? You know, re-educate them. The more tolerance. Let's just re-educate them. We could do that. But then there are others. Will say, of course, those who fail at re-education will get stronger measures. The medications. Those who fail at the medications will get the laser lobotomies. Those that the laser lobotomies fail will probably get the shredder. So a second dwelling place is really what's needed, for sure, to sort out the goat. The goats and the sheep don't belong together. They really don't belong together. Two opposite directions. And the spiritual will of the sheep, as they gather their spiritual will, terrifies the goats. It terrifies those, the egomaniacs. the ego, the personality cultists are terrified by it. They think it's madness. They think, oh my God, this is complete madness. They freak out. So in this world, you don't see real spiritual will in this world. You don't. To get some role models. I'm just looking for role models. Where's a role model of spiritual will? Where do you go? Where do you go? Do you go way back 1,000 years ago? No, come on. Can we not get somebody that's in our lifetime, at least, or close, just to make us feel like it's possible? So, who has, this right spiritual will, this pure will, this unalloyed, non-congealed, uncrystallized singularity of spiritual will, and showing us that this is your goal, this is what you can do, so that it helps us gather our will together so we can do these spiritual exercises. Otherwise, you can't do them. Who has it? You see, the ego wants to get rid of that. Wants to get rid of it. It wants to say it doesn't exist. So you can't do the exercises. It's actually a state of total insanity. So why would you even want it? Is what the ego says. man, you gotta laugh at it. It is humorous at one level. It just the sheer whimsicality of it is humorous, if it weren't so terrible in its the suffering that it brings upon us. So you get this practice that you can do. In the recent video I did yesterday was How to Bless the World, has all this practicing in it. You can go to that video and see what's possible. And some of the techniques, one of the root techniques that I'm sharing, that I've gotten from the Holy Spirit, is I have a continuity problem. I have a confession of a continuity problem. I have a total, extremely severe continuity problem. I've forgotten what reality is like. I've forgotten my creator. I've forgotten what created me. I've forgotten what I am. I've forgotten what created me. I've forgotten what I am. I've forgotten my home. I've forgotten how to function. I've forgotten all of that. I have a super severe continuity problem. That's the fundamental basic confession that's necessary. Now, only the cure for the continuity problem is the vision of oneness. It is the cure. It's the only cure there is. It's how we are reminded of reality. Vision of oneness reminds us of reality so that we can end up dropping all our projections. All our whimsicality is actually whimsicality. Pretending to not be whimsical, but it is really, existence is actually totally whimsical. It has no real meaning, no real purpose, no real goal, no real objective, no success, nothing. But it all pretends it's like it's purposeful, like it's really getting somewhere. It's not. But if we didn't pretend, we would say, hey, wait a minute, there's nothing here. Let me turn to the Holy Spirit, I got a continuity problem. So I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem I have. I don't have any other problem. The vision of oneness is the only value there is. Only the vision of oneness is valuable because it solves the only problem that I have. I don't need something else that doesn't solve a non-existent problem. That has no value to me. It has no value to me. That's why, like all the schooling and stuff, I said it has no value. I said this is totally valueless to me because nothing is being said about the vision of oneness and dealing with the continuity problem. Nothing. So I saw no value in it. And it's super hard to focus on what has no value for you. You get depressed. I got super depressed in school. I said, I'm spending all this time what has absolutely no value. So whenever some thought arises that's not aligned with right spiritual practice and the vision of oneness, just say, this has no value for me. Just say, this has no value for me. Squelch it just that way. Don't say anything like, this has no value for me. No value. There's no value there. This is not the vision of oneness. This has no value. Okay? It has no value. It's not realigning your valuing with the vision of oneness because you perceive what you value. So you have to align your valuing with the vision of oneness first before you perceive it. You don't perceive it first and value it and secondly. You value it first and then perceive it. So valuing comes before perception. Okay? So we have to practice our valuing. There's no other way. Have to practice our valuing. Therefore, if anything comes up that is not our practice of our valuing, just say, no value to that. There's no value. And that's it. What has no value is no purpose of engaging it whatsoever. No value. Now, Another root practice is to get centered when you feel like, how do I get started practicing? You say, this moment just as it is totally free of all specialness. Totally free of all specialness. This is a root statement that leads us into spiritual practice. This moment as it is totally free of all specialness. This place, we're in some place, this place as it is totally free of all specialness. This day as it is totally free of all specialness. This planet as it is, meaning just this, just now, either before or after this instant, just now, as it is totally free of all specialness. Say this, and this, what this does is gathers your spiritual will together enough so that then you can start doing some other practices. This, what happens in this world is our spiritual will gets scattered, very easily scattered here, because the egoic agenda is so extremely powerful here and strong, and it's hard to avoid it. It fragments our spiritual will, and we feel like we can't do the practices. I mean, just after like last night, I did like 2 hours of intensely successful spiritual practice, and then today I'm thinking like, I can't even think of anything to practice at all. Like, my will is just zero. See, so it gets everybody. So you have to gather your will together before you can really practice effectively. So you make the confession first and work on that first and say, I have a severe continuity problem. It's the only problem that I have. I don't have an ego problem. I have a continuity problem. Okay? I don't have a perception problem. I have a continuity problem. Put everything, every problem the ego tries to say you have this problem, other than the continuity problem, say no. I only have a continuity problem. Because the one problem the ego doesn't want you working on is the continuity problem. It's the end for the ego. When you accept you have a continuity problem, it's curtains for the ego. It's only a matter of time, short time maybe, where it's finished. So it'll say, hey, let's work on this problem. Hey, let's work on that problem. Say, no, I don't have that problem. I have a continuity problem. I'm going to work on the continuity problem, which means reorienting our valuing to the vision of oneness. That's all that it means. That's the only thing that works. Valuing comes first, then perception. So we have, if we're not seeing the vision of oneness, it's because we don't value it. Therefore, we have to work at the level of valuing. And that takes the right spiritual practice that directly works on our valuing. It works on our expectations. It works on our cognitive valuing and expectations. So if we value a certain type of conceptual framework, we won't see the vision of oneness. If we change our valuing, so we value a different conceptual framework that is akin to the vision of oneness, then it's easy to walk through that door and see it. We will perceive it. So that's the exercise I've asked the Holy Spirit to show me, some exercises that will be helpful for not only me but for everyone. And so once we've gathered our spiritual will with a confession of a continuity problem, the confession of valuing only the vision of oneness has value, then saying this moment as it is totally free of all specialness, gathering our spiritual will together, then we can start in on some heavy duty alignment of our valuing with the vision of oneness. And we use words, we use qualifying words, for instance, like non-concretized, non-reified, which means taking something that's abstract and singular and turning into plural, okay, crystallizing into plurality, to compoundness. No, we're looking for what is non-reified, okay? We're looking for something that is the ultimate, the total, the groundless, the locationless, the pure singularity, the everywhereness that is God, is our home, is our identity. It doesn't have a location, it's locationless. It's non-localized. There's another way of putting it. Yeah, non-localized, totally non-localized. I am viewing this totally, this plant as it is totally non-localized. This table as it is totally non-localized. So you can take something that you feel is localized, it is a thing, it is a reified thing, concretized thing, and say this table as it is totally non-localized. It is totally, so you're preparing to see it that way, that it's actually totally non-localized, because it's the one identity. which has no, is non-localized. It doesn't have any location. It's everywhere. So, formless, formless, non-related, non-related. How can it be related? If it's everywhere, how can it be related? Relation, related to something means I'm here, you're there. It means localized, right? I'm located here, you're located there. The one everywhereness is non-localized, non-concretized, and it is formless, and it is non-related. The non-related, okay? It's not a thing related to some other thing. There is no thing relatedness whatsoever. Non-other, non-other. There is no other. It's not that there's everywhereness and then there's an other that everywhereness is relating to. No. Everywhereness is abiding in itself. It's the everywhereness of everywhereness that is taking place. That's the only relationship there is the everywhereness of the everywhereness, and it's not some other. It's not an other. It's the non-otherness. Okay, as it isness. The as it isness. Everything is the as it isness. It is always as it is. Everywhereness is always as it is, exactly as it is. It's not something else. It's not something different. It's not changing. It's always as it is. The residue free. There's no residue of something else within everywhereness. It's not like there's everywhereness and there's this residue of something else, like a faint residue somewhere. We're looking at, where did this residue come from? There is no residueness. There is no residue. It is residue free, totally residue free. Non-defined is totally non-defined. Non-defined. What could define it? What could define it? Who is there that is defining it? Is there something outside of it saying, this is how I define it? It's not things, this thing's definition. Everywhereness is everywhereness. There's no definition per se. It's non-defined. It's everywhere. It's non-defined. It's non-localized. It's non-defined. Process-free. It's process-free. There's no process taking place. Everywhereness is not becoming everywhereness. It's not engaged in some process to become something else, or it's not engaged in some process to be what it is. It already is what it is. It is process-free. It is process-free. Singular. There's only one. There's only one vision of one. There's not two. There's only one everywhereness. There's not two. There's only one great perfection. It's singular. It's singular. It is totally singular. Non-compounded. Non-compounded. It is not built up of compounds. It's not this part and that part put together. And together, we're giant. Together, we're the all good. Together, we're the great perfection. No, it is totally non-compounded. There are no parts to it. It is seamless. There are no parts to it. It is non-fabricated, which is, it's not built up. We're not fabricating it out of some material. We don't take some wood, but I'm going to fabricate the everywhereness out of this wood. There's no fabrication. It's already as it is. It is only as it is. It is what it is. It is as it is. There's no, it's non-fabricated. All right. And it is the singularity. It is simply the singularity. Okay. The effulgent. The effulgent connotes this overflowingness. I could put the overflowingness. It's overflowing with what it is. It just totally is what it is. So it is, you could say, is always overflowing. In some way, it's the effulgent giving off this shining brightness. Is it effulgent? Really, I think it means some shining brightness. But this shiningness is also going to be thought of as overflowingness. Of abiding in itself as it is, so to speak. The equalness, the total equal vision. It's equal everywhere. There's not some concretization or crystallization or aggregation or some concentration of somewhere more than somewhere else. Where we see things, it seems that everything is concentrated in different places. There's all these concentrations, but pure spaciousness is not concentrated anywhere. There's no concentration to it, where It's a thing. In other words, thing means more of something here. There's greater density here than other places. We see this thing, this table, and the spaciousness around it. The table has greater density. So there's more particles, there's more compoundness, more tightly packed compoundness here than in the gas that we call the atmosphere that surrounds it, the atmosphere that surrounds it. But pure spaciousness doesn't have any of that packed density. It's equal density, equalness, equals zero density, actually, equals zero density. Immutable, unchangeable, immutable, can't be changed, absolutely cannot be changed at all. Coincident, it's totally coincident with itself, right? Perfect, pure coincident. Just the one coincident with the oneness. The oneness is coincident with the oneness. Totally. It's not lacking this total coincident resonance as it is, what it is. Inseparable. It can't be separated out. You cannot break it into pieces. It's inseparable, inherently inseparable. Transparent, totally transparent. Zero density. Zero density, zero dimensionality. Totally transparent. You cannot obscure it. You can't put something other than what it is as it is. It's only that. It's only that. It's the idea in the mind of God. It is totally transparent. There's no way to obscure it, in other words, what I'm saying. The isness is only the isness, and so it can't be obscured. It is totally transparent at the level that we're talking about here. It is changeless, changeless, similar to immutable, but changeless denotes just is a greater way of saying just there is never any change that takes place of any kind. Immutable is more of a materialistic term of trying to do something to it in some physical way, but changeless just means even greater sense of there is nothing but what is ever. Unalloyed. You can't add anything to it. You can't mix it in with something else. You cannot alloy it with something. The all good. It is the all good. It is all good. Nothing but the all good. There isn't some other quality. It's the all good. The supreme. The supreme. The supreme. Total authority, total authority. Nothing higher, nothing could be thought of as anything beyond this. You know, just totally supreme. Authentic, the authentic, completely authentic, completely authentic. There's nothing about it that doesn't seem right. It seems completely right. It is absolutely authentic. The unborn, the unborn, the unborn. There is nothing that it came out of, so to speak, something other. It wasn't born of something. It self-sprung as it is. Self-sprung. It is self-sprung. It doesn't come from a mother. It doesn't get born of something. It is inherently in itself what it is. Self-sprung. Core, the very core. Its absolute core. It's all core. It's totally core. It's all core. Okay. It's all the very heart, the very essence, the very center, the total meaning, the essential meaning. It's all that. It's all that. It's only that and all that and only that. The one. Just the one. There's only the one. It's only one. There's just the one. Not one with another. Not one replacing another. It is the self-sprung one. Residue-free. I explained the residue-free. Okay, I already explained that. All-embracing. The all-embracing. The all-embracing. Every awareness must be the all-embracing, right? It's everywhere. How could it not be all-embracing? Inherently, it's all-embracing. It's got to be. That. Just that. Just that. It's just that. It's not something else. It is just that. the intrinsic. Intrinsic. Meaning... what it is self-sprung. Comes from what it is. It's inherent. It's inherency. Has to be there-ness of it. The everywhereness is intrinsically the everywhereness. The traceless. It doesn't follow any path, does it? Everywhereness is not following some path. So there's no trace of it. Trace is like you trace the ant, it follows a path. You trace the car's going on a road. You know, the plane, you can trace the plane, what kind of flight path, the train, plane. Where is everywhereness going? It's not going anywhere. It's already everywhere. So there's no trace of it. You can't trace it. You can't find a trace of it. You can only find all of it. Identical. Totally identical. Everywhere you look, the oneness is identical with the oneness. The everywhereness is identical with the everywhereness. All identical. It's all identical. Baseless. There's no base to it. It's not resting on some base. It's resting on itself. Where does everywhere need a base? Why would it need a base? It's everywhere. It is its own base. It is self-sprung base. So it's baseless. Infallible. How could it not be infallible? How could everywhereness, the baseless everywhereness, not be what it is? It's infallibly, inerrantly, is what it is. Mindless. It doesn't have any mind to be what it is. It is inherently what it is. See, so we say it's mindless, thinking that all this thoughts in our mind, you say it's thoughtless too, mindless, thoughtless. It doesn't require thoughts to be what it is. It is what it is, inherently so. Natural, totally natural. It is true nature. It is what is. Therefore, it is, has to be, completely natural. Because there isn't anything else. How could it not be totally natural then? Spaced out, completely spaced out. Totally spaced out. Which is a way of saying pure spaciousness, but completely spaced out. No matter how you look at it, is this totally spaced outness, everywhereness, can be looked at or said it's totally spaced out. It's the spaced outness, equal everywhere, right? So it just feels, it's just a space, this equal space, like a perfect clear sky. It's just the same everywhere. It's totally spaced out, undifferentiated. Yes, it's not differentiated into levels. There's no differences in everywhereness. Are there differences? There's no differences. So what differentiation can be made? It's undifferentiated. All pervasive. Yeah. All pervasive. The all pervasive presence. There's nowhere where it's not. There's nowhere where it's not there as it is. Uncongealed, unreified, non-concretized, non-reified, non-crystallized, perfect smoothness. It is all pervasive. Nothing blocks it. It's totally transparent. Zero density, all pervasive, everywhere. Non-congealing. It doesn't congeal. It doesn't congeal in some way, you know. It's not like pure spaciousness has some wound and it has to congeal and to heal it or something. It's congealing. No, there's no congealing. It's always totally spaced out. Always totally spaced out. Non-congealing. Unceasing. Ceaseless, unceasing, never stops. Never stops. How can it everywhere stop? Where's the stop sign? Where is there to stop? It can't stop. It's unceasing. Non-crystallizing. It doesn't crystallize into anything. no crystallizing taking place in the pure spaciousness, everywhereness. It's not crystallizing into something, into some density. Zero density doesn't crystallize into density. It doesn't crystallize at all. This is the tough one for us. We think it must crystallize. No, it's totally non-crystallizing. Totally non-crystallizing. Reality is actually totally non-crystallizing. There's no thingness to it. It doesn't get fixed. There's no fixation to it. Non-fixated is another way of putting it. I don't know if I put that down yet. Non-fixated. Let me see. That's a good one. I'll write that down. I probably, did I say that? No. How can everywhereness be fixated anywhere? How could there be fixation? It's meaningless, right, to say it's fixated. It's totally non-fixated. Wide open. Wide open. What is it closed to? Is everywhereness closed to anything? So it must be wide open. This feeling is wide open, totally wide open. Unelaborated. Unelaborated. Why? What elaboration does pure spaciousness need to be what it is? It's a totally unelaborated, isn't it? Uncongealed and non-crystallized, unelaborated. There is no elaboration to it. Immaculate. Immaculate. Totally immaculate. Flawless, you know, flawless. Immaculately, without any blemish at all. It is exactly what it is, without any blemish in any way possible. It is totally immaculate, totally immaculate. So you get these qualifying terms that can remind us, at least conceptually, align our valuing towards the actual experience of the vision of oneness, the actual experience of this immaculateness, this unelaborated, non-fixated, non-crystallizing, unborn, all-pervasive immaculateness, everywhereness, all good, great perfection. It aligns us with that. And so our valuing is going ahead of us, and our valuing will enable us to perceive it. Our valuing will enable us to perceive it. When our valuing gets sufficient, it will dawn. It will dawn upon us. I've already had that happen recently a couple occasions, and I wish I could do it again. I just got into a very intense spiritual practice of value. I really felt I was valuing it so much, and suddenly some just subtle little shift happened. I said, "Oh my God, that's it. That's easy." And I was viewing this immaculate. This pure meaning, full of meaning, overflowing with this pristine, unalloyed meaning of all-inclusiveness, you know, just this quality. And I realized everything was already in that. And just the simplest little shift of focus, or so to speak, depth of field, just kind of a perceptual depth of field, spiritual depth of field shift. And I said, "Of course." I said, "Oh my gosh, this is fantastic." But then I started thinking, well, how do I abide in this? And then something I pulled back from it, right? So we can get glimpses of it, but how do we abide in it? Which is what I'm working on now, which is changing our cognitive expectations, changing our valuing. So we only value the vision of oneness. That's it. That is the valuing we have. And then will be easy to simply abide in it, because we're simply perceiving it, because we're perceiving what we value. So we just say, "Well, I'm just simply perceiving it. That's all." And you know, I remember when I was younger and I was perceiving, I was able to perceive in a very spiritual way, and people would ask me, "You know, how in the world are you doing that?" And I'd say, "Well, what do you mean? It's just obvious. It's right here. I'm just perceiving it. How was I perceiving it? Because I valued it." And I didn't understand the fact that they didn't value it at all. And therein lay the problem. So that's when I got into conflict with the world, is because The world demanded an explanation based on their valuing of how they can see it. They didn't want to change the value because of fear of the continuity problem. And for me, it was just natural to see it because I valued it. So valuing is perception. There's something very important. So if you're seeing something, it's because you value it. If you're seeing the vision of one, it's simply because you value it. That's all. That's all. And if you don't value it, it's because you have a continuity problem. I mean, then the only way is to work on that continuity problem. There isn't any other way. You have to do it. You have to change your valuing. Otherwise, you will not see it. So I try to explain to them why you're not. I always say, you're not seeing it. You're not seeing this. Why? I said, why aren't you seeing this? And they get very angry and upset with me because they said, well, it's obviously it's not there. What do you mean? Why am I not seeing it? I'm not seeing it. They weren't valuing it. They're not seeing it because they don't value it. So, really, if you come into this world with spiritual vision, you have to be really, you know, super enlightened. You have to be able to abide in it effortlessly. Otherwise, you're going to get into a conflict with the world, for sure. And I know there are many people in the world who know exactly what I'm talking about. They have a more expanded, more wide open vision because their valuing is such that it enables that. And this world here, people just say, "What do you? You must be crazy. What are you talking about? You're trying to make a fool of me. What are you talking about? You see a subtle form here. You see past lives, or you can see this all this expanded range of what you can perceive." They say, "I don't see anything. Yeah, you're just trying to make a fool out of me." No, they don't see it because they don't value it. They don't value it because out of fear of the continuity problem. Out of fear of the continuity comes allegiance to the ego. Out of allegiance to the ego comes adherence to some of its strange religious teachings of trying to combine, of saying that we don't have a continuity problem because our desire that God die is perfectly normal and natural for us, and we should actually accept that as our fundamental essential belief, and that'll somehow save us. Once we die, we'll be saved. And that kind of stuff, we get into that then, and then we're not able to value. That prevents us from valuing the vision of oneness, because then you'll see that spiritual death's impossible. That everything is eternal life, just as it is eternal life. How can you then say that something can die eternally? Eternal death is possible. You'll see it's impossible, and therefore you know the ego is just utter nonsense. It's just a silly, whimsical projection on our part. And the ego doesn't want anybody to see that. So, of course, people in this world don't see it because they don't value it, because they've been trained not to value it out of fear of the continuity issue. So I'm saying, in order for success to truly be reborn, we have to, in my opinion, make the continuity problem the root teaching of it, the root recognition. And people have to work on this because it's not easy. I know people say, "What is the continuity problem? I don't understand what you're talking about." Yeah, you have to work at it. You have to work at it. But it's not that difficult to explain. You know, it's just simply, you know, there are different ways you can explain, but it's just basically a sudden, abrupt change. I mean, if you're sitting here and suddenly you make this shift and you suddenly realize there are no things, there's never been any things. It's only one eternal life. And you're going to say, whoa, wait a minute, what happened to all the things? How did I get here? What happened? What happened to my old perception? Am I being attacked? Is this craziness? You know, that's a continuity problem. It's an abrupt transition in change in experiencing where the new experience is totally unlike the previous one. So, and you realize it's permanent. And you'll say, "Wow, this is too abrupt. I can't handle this. This is scaring me. I'm afraid I'm going to lose my sense of continuity." We kind of feel continuity is identity. So if the change is too abrupt, we feel we've lost our identity. That's the problem we have. We can't remember reality at all. So we're afraid to go back to reality, to remember reality, afraid to wake up from our coma. That's the continuity problem. Everybody has it. Everybody has it extremely severely. So it has to be recognized for real momentum to get going. It has to be recognized. You know, and the ego's saying these days, you don't worry about it. Just go do yoga, stretch, get a nice asana, count your breath, relax your mind, think happy thoughts. I'm a kind person. I'm a loving person. I'm easy to get along with. I get along with other people. I'm okay. You're okay. Breathe. Breathe. I like people. I like animals. I like my co-workers. I feel peaceful with my co-workers. Okay, oh, yeah, the ego says, that's what you need to do. That's all you need to do. Just get along so we can all fabricate together. Build these swankier hotels so they can rot. Remember, the desire to annihilate, it has to have something to annihilate, or where's the demonstration of its power? The desire to everything to subside has to have something, everything arise first so it can subside. The idea of destruction must have something first arise to destroy, to break down. First must have this compounding take place so that then it can be broken down, right? Uncompounded, broken down. So, of course, there are all these what we think are things in the world. And when it disappears, we say, wait a minute, how can I break anything down? How can I give any evidence of my power over God, that I'm greater than God, if there aren't any things to break down? I'm seeing only the one. How can I break it down? I can't. And people like freak out. Really? Continuity problem is a nasty, difficult, serious problem. Really serious problem. You really have to dedicate your life to it, you say, because there's so many fears that come out of it. Like, again, I can't, there's nothing to break down. Breaking down is my salvation, we think. You know, we have such a crazy idea of our salvation. We think that to succeed in replacing God is our salvation, that we need to get this power of breaking something down. We need to break down reality. We think we need to break down oneness. And so all these things are evidence of power breaking down, all this compoundness breaking down. It's just densities, different areas of density, of apparent density, really. It's just imaginary density, really. And then we think it gets broken down. Say, you see? Look at the power there is to break down all that stuff. Look at this will. There's this will that's breaking everything down. It must be God. It's the ego. It's God. God can, no matter what I make, compound, whatever's compounded, is all broken down. You see? There's this great power that even going to break me down into nothing. So, not seeing that, just oneness, nothing broken down at all. You'll panic if you're not prepared for it. And you'll think you're damned, you're eternally damned. I got no ability to succeed. So it takes a while to work on the continuity problem, to make a soft landing in the vision of oneness. It takes a while. You have to work at it. You have to be smart about it. You have to be dedicated to it. And so with the ego saying that goal has to be sacrificed so we can combine the two. Now, in my opinion, if Jesus was sacrificed, crucified, it was because he was showing us the way of this world, the wickedness, the evil, the insanity of this world. He was pointing it out to us. The world says, look, we need to make mutual exclusives compatible. We need this treaty here. We need to get along, both sides here need to get along. So each side has to sacrifice what is most precious to us. So what is your sacrifice? And so we said, well, we'll sacrifice Jesus, who's pointing out the purity of our practice and the purity of the goal, and is most oriented in that direction. And there, okay, we'll give him up if you give up your desire to what to annihilate us or something. So it was like a deal. So let's make a deal. We'll get rid of our ultimate goal if you get rid of your ultimate goal. That's kind of the deal. Like, so we said, okay, you can kill Jesus if you'll give up trying to annihilate us. And the ego said, oh, okay, deal. Of course, it was lying. It can't give up its fanatic desire to annihilate us because it's a projection. It can't give it up. So it was a useless deal. Useless deal. Jesus was just pointing out to us, what are we trying to do? We're willing to sacrifice the vision of oneness here, hoping the ego will sacrifice its goal of trying to annihilate us. The ego cannot sacrifice its goal. when it says it is or can, it's lying. It's lying. And it's covering up its lie. It hasn't given up that goal. Therefore, we don't have to give up the vision of oneness. It's useless. It's useless. Totally useless. So we, once again, need to recollect our spiritual will and say, no, the vision of oneness is my only goal. Pff, period. No deals, ego. No more. No deals. Can't make a deal. Wide, free table, just as it is. Just as it is the immaculate, non-fixated, spaced out, all good, everywhereness. Without another. See? It is that. It is that right now. So, no deals. Can't make a deal with the ego. Very important to realize that. Since you can't make a deal with the ego, why is anyone still trying? It's folly. Folly. Since you can't make a deal with the ego, it means you don't have to give up your most precious asset, which is the vision of oneness. What you value most is the vision of oneness. What the ego values most is your annihilation. In fact, what you value, the only value we really have is the vision of oneness. The only value the ego has is our annihilation. Since it cannot give up our annihilation, that valuing, there is no deal to be made. It's totally useless. So there's no reason whatsoever for us to give up the vision of oneness. That's the only thing that's really valuable is the vision of oneness, quote unquote thing. Only the vision of oneness has value. So, there's no deal to be made, so don't give it up. Work on it intensely. Work on it intensely. When the ego says, hey, I got a deal for you, it's lying. It's lying. The ego only values our annihilation, and the only problem we have is a continuity problem, and that's only solved by the vision of oneness, so only the vision of oneness has value for us. It's either that, or just waste time thinking you're making a deal with the ego when you're not. Think that you're in a high-level negotiation with ego when you're not. There is no negotiation taking place. People are wasting their whole lives negotiating and deal-making with ego when nothing is taking place, nothing whatsoever. So it's total waste of time. And so don't be that time waster. Just turn to the vision of one and say, okay, I'm going to practice what needs to be practiced. So, may the peace of peace and the bliss of bliss and the great perfection of the great perfection and the all-seeing of the all-seeing and the awake mind of the awake mind and the intrinsic, effulgent, ultimate, total, baseless and traceless, inseparable, transparent, zero dimensionality, zero density, core, pure matrix of everywhereness being be upon that which is neither inside you nor outside of you, but entirely upon you as one without another. All right, very great. And we will continue gathering our will and aligning our valuing with the vision of oneness so we can see the vision of oneness. All right, very great. That's it.